So John, fill us in a little bit about how you prepare the band. So once you've received information from the client, or maybe how you get the information from the client, and then how you convey that to the band to prepare them for the day.
Excellent. So one of the things that I make sure a couple understands, maybe early on in the booking process, but certainly as we get a couple of months out from their event, most of them understand this at some level, but it's important that they realize this isn't quite as simple as just handing off a list to your favorite DJ.
Yes.
It's a more organic thing to have a working band of musicians. Even if it's a long song list, it's still a human process. So what I usually do is I have a planning document that has line items of, you know, special dance choices, that kind of thing, other optional moments like tosses and entrances, stuff like that, private dance at the end if they want it, or just a jubilant last dance to choose, and then a place for them to put client requests. From there, they look at a document that's basically a working template set list that's huge. It's got options on page 2 and a kind of an approximate way they could look at it. They could pick all their favorites, X out ones they don't want. So I get them going on that, and then they can use another list that's kind of the outer margins of our repertoire. You probably have this, you know, songs that you learned once or maybe fell out of rotation.
Sure.
But you basically could dust it off.
Yes.
So I make sure they understand, like, this, we can't like just go everywhere, but you can pick a handful of those dust off ones, because
okay,
we'll review them. We can learn a special song for you. And so I kind of walk them through. I don't have to know right now exactly what time anything happens. Mm-hmm. And certainly don't fret over how many to pick, because they'll sometimes say, how many of these do I got
to
pick?
They think they have to fill.
Yeah,
the
you don't have
time
to put an order or anything. That's on us.
Yes.
And I always tell them we come over prepared. We'll have way more music ready than is needed. But if you highlight the ones on our template that you for sure want, they're going to be in that order in bold. And we will, if we have to start skipping stuff, it won't be the ones they requested.
Right.
And even then, we usually wind up not even getting to all of it.
Yes.
So those kinds of processes. But I turn to the band, and I give them all kinds of that documentation weeks out.
Yes.
So they know what they might have to personally prepare, review, etc. And then we rehearse a little bit, sometimes to rehearse a new song or dust things off, like I said. So
yes,
so it's a very organic process, but I try for it to be organized.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't get up to the event and go, wait, we can't do that one. You
right,
know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I would just throw in a little 2 cents here on that is, I've had to really educate clients over the years. I don't know how this started, but it became like a thing of crossing out of these do not plays. Like they thought if there was a song they didn't know, they crossed it out.
Right.
You know, and it got to where the lists, which were vast, got really whittled down to like, you know, very much
not
trying your
play
hands. And it wasn't so much the lack of material, but I've tried to explain to the client, like, if there's a song you absolutely can't stand or an artist, yes, please cross it out. We don't want to play that at your event. But if you cross out so many, it really limits our ability to read the vibe of the room,
mm-hmm,
because we're typically calling songs based on what's happening
response,
in the
yeah
room and the response of the crowd. And if you're having to, you know, scroll through a list of, you know, things that have been crossed off, it's like, what can I play next? It does sometimes affect the ability to really keep the party moving along the way it should. So I try to tell them to be a little bit conservative with the do not plays, because it seems like they like to get sharpy happy sometimes, and then you're like, hey, we have 5 songs.
I had an awesome moment one time, way before we met you, where we were literally near the end of the event, and all the bridesmaids started hollering, play Don't Stop Believing, please don't stop
and the client didn't want
it. Right. Well, we didn't know, but it was on the list as a marked off do not do, and we're going to honor that, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we kill that song. You,
yeah,
you kill that song. It's a fine. I even have put a horn score on it, you know,
yeah,
a horns jam on that.
Yeah.
But so it's no offense. We're not going to play it. And now we see this happening, and we're like, we better not do it. So while we're playing something else, this lead singer turns to me and goes, they said, what should we do? You know, so we pause for just a second, and this sweet lead singer leans over to the maid of honor and says, they crossed that off their list. And she said, no way, that's her favorite song. And so they were like, well, then someone didn't want it. So guess what? We played
so
it.
So you played it, right? And you just
I think
it
was mom or dad that didn't want it.
That's so funny. And they end the night with it. But and those things happen all the time.
Yeah, but we had to kind of go, wait a minute. So,
But we navigate through, and we're really looking for a roadmap from the client. with some specifics more than you have to write down every song for your reception in order that we'll play them.
I think, yeah, they can get a little, like you said, a little Sharpie happy. The best approach is to be like, truly, clearly, a handful, don't play,
yes.
We can't stand it, or
yeah.
It's rude, or
yeah.
whatever. And then if we get a lot of favorites, great.
Great, then we're
And then
good.
If they basically understand, look, we also trust you all
yes.
to do what you do best,
again.
And you've got experience, that two-way street is super helpful.
Agreed.